Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is John Sheldon. I'm the Executive Director of the George C. Marston Institute. I'd like to thank you all for coming out today, especially in this miserable weather. So thank you for those who braved. I see one or two literally drowned water rats here, so thank you. I just have a few administrative notices before I hand things over to Bill O'Keefe, our CEO, who will then introduce Professor Happer. We will be letting Professor Happer do his presentation. It will last about 30, 40 minutes. And then we'll open the floor to questions and answers. Helen here will be coming around with a microphone for the questions. So if you want to ask a question, please raise your hand. I'll identify you. Please wait for the microphone. Give your name and affiliation. Don't worry if the microphone doesn't appear to be working. It is. The microphone is purely for the video, which we'll be posting online probably tomorrow on the George C. Marston Institute website. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our CEO and Managing Director of the Marshall Institute, Mr. Bill O'Keefe. Bill.
Thank you, John. It is a first, thank you for coming out in not the best of weather. It's a personal pleasure for me to introduce Will Happer. Not only is he the chairman of the board of the Marshall Institute, but I consider him a very special friend. I also consider him a scientist whose commitment to principles takes him wherever the facts lead him, independent of what other people think or prevailing views. He also has a great sense of humility for someone who is so brilliant and accomplished, but above all, he has the courage of his convictions to do the right thing and let the chips fall where they may, and I suspect the title of his talk demonstrates that fact. So Will, thank you for coming down from Princeton, and thank you for chairing the Institute's board.
Thank you. Well, thanks very much, Bill, and thank you all for coming out on such a threatening day. I guess we won't have to go to the stairwell to wait out a tornado. I hope not. So the title of my talk is The Myth of Carbon Pollution. So let's go on. First of all, I should say that you might ask, why am I talking about climate? I am a physicist, but I've actually been working in climate physics, climate-related physics, for a long time. I was the co-author of one of the first books on impacts of carbon dioxide levels on weather and climate. So I've been interested in this since 1982. I will say that, you know, we made an estimate of the climate sensitivity in 1982, which turned out to be right in the middle of the fancy computer model. We did it with slide rules, actually, but it was about the same. And it's grossly high. You know, so when I criticize other people about having overestimated climate sensitivity, I'm criticizing myself, too. We got it badly wrong. And I'll just show you how wrong in a minute. CO2, the so-called pollutant, has been demonized because it supposedly causes catastrophic global warming. Well, this is not true, it's false. And in fact, it's very clear now from the observations over the past two decades, practically, that the warming from CO2 has been grossly exaggerated, not just a little bit, by factors of two or three, maybe more. So whatever CO2 can do, I believe it will cause some warming, but it will be small warming, and the amount of warming will actually probably be good. And on top of that, the direct effects of CO2 on plant growth will be even better. So agricultural productions will increase around the world, and you can already see that from satellite images of chlorophyll. I'll show you some examples of that. Well, there are a lot of people who tell you the opposite. Perhaps the most famous is a Nobel laureate in climate science, Al Gore, and this is the cover of his book. This is a book that actually, it's a cover that folds back, so this is the crease, so the actual length of the cover is this much, and you can pull out the inner part to see this, and it says, when you look at this, this is taken from NASA, so I did a little research, and I got some help from some of my friends in NASA to find the origin of this, and so here is the actual photograph that Al used. He and his associates did a little bit of creative airbrushing on the thing, and let me just point out, the main thing they did was they removed most of the clouds, Now, it turns out, you know, clouds are quite important. You can see this, that, you know, what is keeping the surface of the Earth from heating up is at least as much clouds as anything else. Where there are white, low clouds, the surface doesn't get hot. And so probably the mistake that we made and most models have made is that clouds have been underestimated by a very large factor, effects of clouds. But let me go back so you can see the difference. So here's Al's cover. Here's the actual photo. They're similar, but you can go and open the book's cover and look on the inner part of the cover. So here's the inner part of the cover. And now you see what's going to happen if we don't pay attention to a climate scientist Gore. The whole Earth is now covered with hurricanes. Everywhere you look, there's a hurricane. To me, a physicist, the most alarming one is this one here. This one's actually rotating the wrong way. You know, hurricanes don't rotate this way. Hurricane rotation is driven by the rotation of the Earth. And so this is very alarming to me. You see, this one's rotating in the correct direction. Here's another worrisome thing. Is there's a hurricane right off of Ecuador. You can see it's Ecuador. This is the intertropical convergence zone along the equator where the trade winds are converging. And no one has ever seen a hurricane at the equator. Apparently, you know, Nobel Prize winner Gore wasn't aware of this. But this is a plot of all known hurricanes. I think it's from Wikipedia. Anyway, it's easy to find this data. And you can see the equator doesn't have hurricanes. And the reason for that is the twist of a hurricane, the direction it rotates, is determined by the rotation of the Earth. So you look down on the north, the Earth appears to be rotating counterclockwise. If you look on the South Pole, the Earth appears to be rotating clockwise. So that's the way hurricanes rotate. If you're a hurricane, a would-be hurricane at the equator, you can't figure out which way I'm supposed to rotate, so you don't form at all. So there are no hurricanes along the equator. But there are on Al's book. Okay, now I don't want to be too flippant here, but the point is the people who speak the strongest and in the most alarming terms about climate don't know anything about the physics of climate. Not even such simple things as this, as which directions do hurricanes rotate, and where do hurricanes form? And he says, all the climate, you know, 97% of climate scientists agree with me. Surely they don't agree with this, you know. Of course they don't. It's a myth. Well, okay. Now, all this alarmism, and it's a good idea to remember what you learned in kindergarten, you know, from listening to fairy tales, that, you know, if the sky seems to be falling, often somebody like the fox is involved. So this is Chicken Little running out of the coop, and acorn has hit her head, and she thinks the sky is falling, but it's the fox dropping the acorn. And I keep reading op-eds about have to do something about the pollutant carbon. They usually say carbon, not carbon dioxide. And I notice it's written by Hank Paulson. Hank Paulson, a partner of Al Gore, stood to make billions of dollars from the carbon exchange. That's never mentioned in the op-eds, you know. But lots of people profit from alarmism. Okay, so we're supposed to decarbonize the world. And I sort of like, you know, German culture, because they have this wonderful word, the Die Gretchenfrage. You know, this is the question that Gretchen asked Faust in the garden when he was courting her. I won't tell you what the question is, but there are two Gretchenfragen for CO2. One is that if you could magically keep CO2 levels constant, whatever you like, 280 preindustrial, 350, you know, McKibben's, whatever he wants, 400 what it is today, would climate stop changing? The answer is, of course not. The climate is not stable. It's never been stable. It won't be stable no matter how many laws we pass. And then the second is, okay, if you're so powerful and you can control CO2 and there's what level should it be? What's the optimum level of CO2? Did we live in the Garden of Eden with just the right level in 1850 with our dark satanic mills and everything that went with it. You know, you would think, again, I had to read Candide when I was in college, and Candide was continually told that he lived in the best of all possible world. There he is. So did we really live in the best of all possible worlds with CO2? Well, at 150 parts per million, which is not much below pre-industrial levels, plants actually stop growing and they die. Most plants die. So the CO2 levels that have been around for several million years are close to the minimum that will sustain plant life. We're now at 400 parts per million. 1880, it was 200 parts per million. But if you look over geological time, the levels have been much, much higher than now. We're living fundamentally in a CO2 famine now. The CO2 levels are much lower than normal. I'll show you some data. Well, first of all, let's talk about climate stability. Here is temperature from proxy records over about a million years, the lower trace here. These are the periodic ice ages. Here we are now in an interglacial. We just came out of the last ice age about 20 million years ago, 15 million years ago. This was the last interglacial 120 million years ago, and then there have been various other interglacials like today. But most of the time, the world is in ice, not a very pleasant place to live. And this is only for the last 800,000 years. If you go back 6 million years, you see we sort of dropped into this ice age fairly recently. And the climate was actually much better and quite a bit warmer, 4 or 5 million years ago. So we're in an unusual time now, not a particularly good time for life, a very, very unstable climate. Well, it's true that there's been some warming in the past 2 centuries. Actually, most of the warming was not in the 1900s, it was in the 1800s, long before there was much additional CO2. And one of the first to notice this and write about this was John Muir. John Muir founded the Sierra Club. He was a co-founder of the Sierra Club. And John Muir got these alarming messages, letters from Alaska, saying that the glaciers are melting in Alaska. This was 1879. There was no major change of CO2 in 1879. So he actually went to Alaska. I've read his book. I recommend it, Travels in Alaska. It's probably in your library here. And let me show you what he found. But let me just first what he said. When he got to Glacier Bay in Alaska, he found this 60-mile-long bay full of water when everyone told him it should be full of ice, that it had been full of ice in the memory of people still alive. And so let me show you Glacier. So here's Glacier Bay. And Glacier Bay was first charted by Vancouver in the late 1700s, 1780, 1790. And so this red line was his chart. And the chart was excellent. If you look at his charts, you can still use his charts for navigation today, everywhere where there was not ice. But all of the ice that was there when Vancouver first came in the very late 1700s, look where it was when, I'm sorry, I don't have a pointer, but you can see 1879 was up there. Essentially, all the ice was gone when John Muir got to Glacier Bay in 1879. So sure, the ice, it is true, the Arctic is warming, ice is disappearing, but it doesn't have anything to do with CO2. Most of it happened long before there was any increase in CO2. In fact, it's quite interesting. Muir asked the Indians, the local Indians, about this. They said, sure, the ice has only been here for a few hundred years. That's common knowledge around these parts. Our forefathers used to hunt these grounds. And so there's now a huge lawsuit between the local Indian tribes and the federal government over whose land this newly ice-free land is. Is it the federal park or is it the local Indian tribe? So that's still working its way through the courts, and it's related to this initial, it's related to this melting, which doesn't have much to do with CO2, apparently. Okay, so what's the fuss? The fuss is that it's clear that CO2 levels are increasing. The red line here is CO2 levels versus time. So we've just gone through 400 parts per million last year. The blue line is the measured temperature, and there's some similarity, although the temperature you can see here actually dropped until about 1977. It rose fairly rapidly until nearly 2000, and then it hasn't changed in the last nearly two decades, since about 1998. There's been no increase in temperature. So the correlation is not very good. For most scientific papers, this would not get you very far. The physics is interesting. You notice these oscillations, this is a blow-up of this. So this is the South Pole, this is the North Pole up there, and this is time going this way. So you can see these enormous oscillations up, down, up, down. And what that is summer and winter. People tend to forget how important CO2 is to life and how desperately plants need it. So in the northern hemisphere, where most of the land is and most land plants exist, when the sun is shining in the summer, the forests and the meadows are sucking out CO2 so much that you get drastic drops, many parts per million drops of CO2. While the sun is shining, the summer is warm. As soon as the winter comes, there's no more photosynthesis. The leaves fall and CO2 starts to come out as things decay. And so you're seeing life, summer, winter, summer, winter. It's much less pronounced and of the opposite phase in the southern hemisphere because there's not much land in the southern hemisphere. Most of the land on the Earth is in the north of the equator. There's very little to the south. Okay. I mentioned that we're essentially in a CO2 famine right now. I'm going to take the liberty of borrowing someone's umbrella here. And so this is CO2 levels, and this is time. So this is called the Phanerozoic. This is the Cambrian 550 million years ago. And this is now, today. The point I want to make here is if you look at the scale of CO2, it's not measured in hundreds of parts per million. It's measured in thousands of parts per million. So where we are now, CO2 levels now are unusually low. There's only been once in the past, in the Permian, between the Carboniferous and the Permian, when they may have been as low as they are today. But over this entire long time period, 550 million years, life flourished. Flourished in the oceans, flourished in the land, big coal swamps were formed. And most of life would prefer more CO2. They'd like to go back to the way it was. Well, okay, why is it that people think CO2 is such a huge control on climate and will cause unacceptable warming? It's because if you actually look at our Earth, we're lucky that we have CO2 and water vapor and clouds. Even these ugly clouds today, they help to keep us warm. If there were no clouds or CO2 or water, the Earth would be much too cold to live in. We would not have life. So it's the blanketing effect of clouds and greenhouse gases that keep the surface warm enough. So what happens is the surface is warmed by visible light from the sun when it can get through clouds. We're not getting much sunlight this afternoon. But if it's clear, the surface warms, and then you have to get rid of that heat or else the surface would keep warming. And so the heat is dumped back into outer space by infrared radiation. And that is heavily complicated by the presence of CO2, water vapor, and clouds. If you look at the Earth looking down from space, it looks extremely complicated. If you had infrared color vision, you would see a very brightly colored Earth because of the clouds and the CO2. And it's the slight changes in that color, infrared color, that are supposed to be leading to alarming global warming. You all have to also remember that the Earth, the temperature of the atmosphere is very complicated. It's warmest on the surface where we are now. As you go up, it gets cold rapidly. That's why you go to the mountains in the summer to keep cool. It's a lot. The cooling as you go up is called the lapse rate. Is roughly 6 degrees centigrade per kilometer. And It can be a little higher if it's dry, it can be less if it's wet, but that's a good round number. And so if you start at 20 degrees on the surface, you rapidly fall down to minus 50, minus 60 at the tropopause. And this region where the temperature is dropping very rapidly is the region in which you've got thunderstorms like today, where air is churning up and down and up and down. And so the heat transfer in this region, the first 10 kilometers, is mostly by motion of air. It's not by infrared radiation at all. It's by actual moving warm parcels of air and falling cold parcels of air. It's not until you get to the tropopause, 30,000 feet, 10 kilometers, before radiation begins to dominate, the cooling radiation to space. And that's where this churning motion stops. That's why if you take an airline flight, they like to fly just above the tropopause so that you're not in this violently churning atmosphere that gives you a rough ride. So you tend to try and plot your flight path a little bit above the tropopause. Well, there are large-scale features to this churning motion. The most dramatic is these huge upwellings of warm air, moist air at the equator. And part of that warm air heads north, part of it heads south. It gets humidified as it goes up, so enormous thunderstorms along the equator, deep convection, they call it. And by the time this dehumidified air has to fall down again, typically at about 30 degrees latitude north and south, it's now devoid of water. It's been stripped by this cooling here. And so it comes down, it's being compressed like air in a bike pump, and so it gets very hot. And so these are the belts of deserts. So this 30 degrees north is the Sahara Desert, the Southwest Desert here, you know, Iraq, in the southern hemisphere, the Patagonian Desert, parts of Australia, are on these descending layers. None of this has anything to do with CO2. This is just fluid motion. Here is CO2. CO2 is a linear molecule. Its physics is actually very similar to the physics of a xylophone bar. And so if you tap it, you know, by a photon hitting it, light hitting it, then it will vibrate. And the vibration that is involved in global warming is this bending mode here. It's exactly the same mode that a xylophone bar has. And this has, I like to joke about this, but by chance, its frequency is about 666 waves per centimeter. So, you know, this is the biblical Satan's number, you know, the mark of the beast. So that's a good way to remember it. If you can't remember anything else, if you're superstitious, you can remember that number, and that's CO2. All right, so so here's the spectrum of radiation. So this is the wavelength of visible radiation here, infrared radiation here. And here's sunlight coming in. Sunlight is red, and it's very hot on the sun, 6,000 degrees almost. And that radiation gets through the atmosphere pretty well. There's not much to absorb radiation. So this is the percent absorption here. So very short waves are absorbed because of scattering in the blue light, Rayleigh scattering that makes a pretty blue sky. But as you go to longer wavelengths, there are many absorption bands from these vibrating molecules, all kinds of vibrating molecules. By far, sort of the 800-pound gorilla of greenhouse gases is water vapor. So here's water vapor. Complete absorption at long wavelengths, a little bit of a window here in the infrared, more heavy absorption here, absorption right up into the visible. There's a little bit of visible absorption. It's one of the things that gives the blue color to the ocean. Is these absorption bands. So even in condensed water, you see these bands. Carbon dioxide is the second most important gas. It overlaps a bit with water, which makes it harder for CO2 to make much difference, but it does make a difference. And then there are many other really very minor players that don't matter. Okay, so let me summarize the facts. The facts are that greenhouse warming exists. It's lucky we have it. It keeps the world warm enough to live in. It's also true that CO2 is a greenhouse gas. It will cause more warming if you add more CO2, but it's not a very efficient way to increase the warming. And the key question is, how much does it warm? if it warms as much as alarmists say, that's really a problem. But there's no evidence for that. In fact, there's lots of evidence that shows that that can't possibly be true. There's no way you can take the upper limits of model warming predictions and make them consistent with what we've observed in the last two decades. And if somebody tells you, well, you know, I can fit everything if I make this assumption or that, you should remember a very important point is that it really is fitting. It is not physics. It's not science. It's curve fitting. You know, it's like you would not buy a program from a stock trader, say, I can fit, you know, the stock market for the, you know, the previous 10 years. I got everything exactly right. Just buy my program. You'll get rich. You know, if you buy his program, you'll lose your shirt because, you know, it's not a predictive program. And that's the same sort of programs that are being used here to try to persuade people that they know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. We certainly didn't know what we were doing when we predicted our temperature rise in 1982. So most models predicted about 0.3 degree warming in the last 20 years, last 15 years or so, from 370 parts per million CO2 to 400. There's been none at all. It has not warmed. And in fact, there may have been a slight cooling. And so we're making all these very momentous policy decisions on the basis of science that is wrong. The science is not right. So it doesn't matter that you argue about this discount rate or that discount rate for your economic model. If the science it's based on is wrong, you're wasting your time. Okay. People are noticing this all over the world. This came out just before the last IPCC report in Germany, in Der Spiegel. You know, a left-of-center German weekly, a bit like Time or Newsweek. Anyway, it says researchers are scratching their head over the pause in the warming of the Earth. And so what they're showing here in color is the predictions of models, and the black bars are what's actually observed. These bars continue to be essentially flat. There's been no warming. So it's been another year and a half since then. No change. The embarrassment grows with every passing month. You might ask how reliable is this? It's gotten a lot more reliable, and one of the key reasons for that is Roy Spencer, who's a member of our board, the Marshall Institute, together with John Christie, have heroically put together a satellite system and maintained it, kept it going, to measure the temperature of the entire globe from satellites, where you can't fiddle with the data. It's completely public data. Anyone can look at it. Yeah, very wonderful instruments. And again, you see no drastic warning. These are tenths of a degree. But what you do see is enormous fluctuations in the temperature. This is a big El Nino we had in 1998. This was Mount Pinatubo. El Nino's caused the whole Earth to warm. Volcanic eruptions cause it to cool. The warming isn't very long, nor is the cooling very long. It recovers quite quickly, typically just a few years. Well, and how well have models done? Here's the acid test. And so what I've shown here is an article that came out in Nature roughly a year ago, when people were finally realizing they had a really serious problem. The red bars here are the observed warming. Okay, so A is 1993 to 212. So the observed warming was less than 0.2 degree, and they did everything to try and make it bigger here. The actual true figure is probably even smaller. It might even be negative. This is from 1998 to 212. Here, B is even worse. And that was our prediction in 1982, right in the middle of the pack. So nobody has gotten this right. Nobody has gotten this right. All of the calculations of warming have been grossly overstated, grossly overstated. This amount of warming means nothing. In fact, it's good. I mentioned El Niños. You ought to know what an El Niño is. I'm sure some of you do. But the Pacific Ocean normally has trade winds blowing along the equator because of this returning air I mentioned from the big circulation cells. And because of the rotation of the Earth, the winds have to blow from South America to Australia and Indonesia, and that pushes warm surface water that's been heated by the sun toward Australia and Indonesia. So normally the Pacific has this big bathtub of warm water off Australia and very cold upwelling water off of South America and Mexico. But every now and then the wind stops, and then there's nothing to keep the warm water in the Western Pacific, so it sloshes back to South America and Mexico, and we get an El Nino year like 1998, which was a huge one. Or occasionally you get even stronger trade winds, and you get a La Nina year, in which it's even colder in the Eastern Pacific. So this is a huge effect that you have to take out of actual observations. All right, so here's, let me move now to the fact that not only does CO2 not cause the amount of warming that everybody predicted, much less warming than everyone predicted, but it actually is a huge benefit to agriculture. All right, so this is actually a quiz to the audience. You can improve your grade if you can identify this crop. Who knows what the crop is? Come on, you know you work in America. This is an important American topic. Soybean. I heard the right answer. Very good. Soybean. All right, second question for the audience. Is it genetically engineered? You should be able to look at that and see, tell me. Yes, yes. Why? Another, I grew up in a rural area, so I used to see soybean fields when I was younger, and they didn't look like this at all. Huh? There are no weeds. No, it's not the leaves. It's the fact that there are no leaves. There are no weeds. You know, when I first saw fields like this, I couldn't believe it because, you know, when I was in high school, you know, I used to have jobs on a farm, and soybean fields were full of weeds. This has been modified with a gene that makes it resistant to herbicides. So if you plant this type of soybeans, you can fly over this with an airplane and spray it with herbicide. It kills all the weeds, and the soybeans lap it up, and they grow better. So, and I should say that soybeans is one of the things that is most greedy for CO2. So soybeans are also growing better nowadays than they did 50 years ago, just because there's more CO2. Let me show you some examples of that. So this is a picture of experiments done with a pine species in Arizona. This is Sherwood Idso. And this is ambient CO2 levels, 385 parts per million at the time. And this is increasing amounts that are fed to these plants. And you grow them for several years in an enclosure that where you can control CO2, and you can see this enormous increase in growth as you add more CO2. This is parts per million of CO2. This is just a picture of how you do that. You have these sort of polyethylene enclosures where you can control the CO2 for many years as you watch the plants grow. And with that type of experiment, you can measure what happens to plant growth. And every kind of plant you can imagine, every kind of crop that you can imagine does better with more CO2. So these are the increases that you would get for 300 part per million addition of CO2, 50% for C3 cereal. C3 cereal means wheat. 20% for C4 cereals. That's something like corn or sugar cane. There are not many C4 crops, but some of them are very important. But all of them grow better. And so there's absolutely no dispute about this. More CO2 is increasing agricultural yields. Most people think that about 15% of current agricultural yield is from CO2. So if you could go back to pre-industrial levels, you would immediately lose 15% of the world's food production. It'd be gone. Of course, greenhouse operators learned about this a long time ago. They could care less about scientists. All they want is to make a good product in their greenhouse they get a good price for. And so if you go on the internet, you can find lots of gadgets like this. This is the sales pitch. This, for this one, CO2 enriched at 2, 3, and 4 times natural concentration will cause plants to grow faster, improve plant quality, the blah, blah, blah generator of automatically provides the carbon dioxide to meet the maximum growing potential. These are cheap. They're essentially propane burners. Now, if you're a greenhouse operator, you might think the cheapest way to get CO2, you go buy a bottle of CO2, like a propane tank. But in fact, it's much cheaper to buy propane itself, to burn the propane, exhaust the propane into the greenhouse, and that gives you CO2 at, a fraction of the cost of actually buying pure CO2. That reminds me, I like to tell people of William Faulkner had this recipe for Mississippi hush puppies, where you first go down to the river, you catch a bunch of catfish, and then you get the oil boiling, and you put the catfish, batter them up, put them in, and then you put the right spices in the batter. And as soon as everything is ready, you drop the batter in, you get these nice fragrant hush puppies, then you throw away the catfish and the oil, and you eat the hush puppies. So this is sort of what you do. Probably, you throw away what you think is the valuable part. Okay. Why does this happen? This is not a mystery, actually. It's easy to understand. It's important you understand this. If you don't go away with anything else, I hope you'll go away with this. If you look at a plant leaf, any plant leaf, if you put it under a microscope, has little holes in the leaf. These are stomata. They're there because the plant gets its CO2 from the atmosphere. It doesn't get it through its roots. It has to diffuse in through the atmosphere. And if you don't have enough stomata, you don't get enough CO2 to photosynthesize, to make the sugars and cellulose and other things that plants make. But your problem as a chemical engineer for the plant is that for every CO2 molecule that diffuses into your leaf, of the order of 100 water molecules diffuse out, under bad conditions. And so if you actually do the accounting, a typical plant to make a gram of carbohydrate, sugar or cellulose, uses about 100 grams of water. So that's easy to measure. So plants are absolute water hogs, and the reason is that they lose water in the process of photosynthesis itself. So the real reason that plants do better if you add CO2, at least in the wild and open fields as opposed to a greenhouse, is that the water economy is much better. When a plant senses that there's twice as much CO2 in the air, and which they've experienced many times in the geological past, plants are used to changing CO2. They simply grow leaves which have half as many stomata. Then they lose half as much water, so they can grow where it's much drier, and they can cope with years that are drought years. And this, in fact, is one of the proxy methods for estimating CO2 levels in the past. This particular paper was estimating CO2 levels in Europe 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, and this is a dwarf birch leaf from a bog in Denmark, I think, somewhere in Northern Europe. And this is the microscope picture of it. And by counting these stomatas and then counting the same leaf of a modern plant that just grew last year, you can infer what the CO2 levels were. So, in fact, when this plant actually grew, the number of stomata is the same as today. So the inference is that 6,000 years ago, CO2 levels were around 400 parts per million, the same as today. You can read about it in this paper. I put the reference if you want to check it. On the other hand, if you look at a leaf from a herbarium in Europe, a museum, from 200 years ago, you find that it has many more stomata, noticeably many more. And so the stomatal index then is one of the most interesting and dependable ways to estimate past CO2 levels. Well, this is what you see looking down from satellites at chlorophyll spectral bands on the Earth. And what you see is that the whole Earth is getting greener. So green means more chlorophyll over the past 20 years. So this is 1982 to 2010, where it's green means that there's more plant growth today than there was in 1982. And you can see it's particularly pronounced at the edge of the desert. Here's the Sahel, south of Sahara. Here's the Western Desert in Australia, Western India, Central Turkey. there's really only one way to account for this, and that is that the plants just don't need as much water as they used to. So they can grow now where they couldn't grow even 30 years ago. Okay, a few final things, and we'll have a discussion. This, by the way, is agricultural production in India of wheat. In 1960, wheat production was under 10,000 units here. Now it's up to, I don't have it up to the current, but it's over 100,000 now. So it's been more than a factor of 10 increase in wheat production in India. This is when Paul Ehrlich predicted everyone would be dead of starvation by about here. And by the way, this is when Norman Borlaug started to do serious research on better varieties of wheat for the third world, for India and Mexico. And so these are two heroes. One of them is a real hero, Norman Borlaug. Everything he did actually worked. And one of them is a phony, you know, but who's in charge of U.S. policy today, him and his students. Okay, so that's what's actually happened. It's real data. Well, even the fanatics realize now that there hasn't been any warming. They've conceded that point at last. So they've dropped back to climate change, you know, extreme events. Again, this I think is from John Christie, but it shows if you actually look at extreme events, there's nothing changing in extreme events. So the weather we're having today, it's bad, but it's the same weather that Thomas Jefferson and George Washington observed and when they lived. And tornado frequency is not changing with increasing time. Snow cover is not really changing. Red drought years, green wet years, not changing. So again, it's a myth that there's more extreme weather. The myth that Hurricane Sandy was caused by CO2, you know, how can anyone believe that? You know, some people apparently do. Okay, sea level is another of the alarmist things. Sea level has had an enormous rise when the northern ice sheets melted. It was 120 meters or so. But there's been practically no rise since. There's been no acceleration. So sea levels are completely normal. Carbon dioxide emissions, I don't see anything bad about them. But what we do, what Europe does, it almost is irrelevant because this red line is emissions from China. So China is way ahead of everyone in the world. And India is rapidly catching up. So it really doesn't matter what we do. So let me summarize in, and we'll go to questions, although I do want to show one very short video clip. The policies to slow CO2 emissions are based on flawed computer models. Models are not right. It doesn't matter what you do with the economics. If you put in the wrong initial data, garbage in, garbage out. And the warming has been exaggerated by at least a factor of 3. And furthermore, more CO2 is actually a benefit. So mitigation schemes are costly. They're harmful. They don't help the world. They actually harm the world. They harm our progeny. They harm our grandchildren. Well, Schopenhauer is a great source of quotes. He says, all truth passes through 3 stages. First, it's ridiculed. Secondly, it's violently opposed. And third, it's accepted. It's self-evident. And I think what we've discussed today, the truth that CO2 is not harmful, but actually good for the planet, somewhere between the stage of ridicule and violent opposition. So that's where we are now. So let me just show a quick clip.
Now I'm going to discuss how we would look for a new law. In general, we look for a new law by the following process. First, we guess it. Well, don't laugh, that's really true. Then we compute the consequences of the guess. To see what, if this is right, if this law that we guess is right, we see what it would imply. And then we compare those computation results to nature. Or we say compare to experiment or experience. Compare it directly with observation to see if it works. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. In that simple statement, is the key to science. It doesn't make a difference how beautiful your guess is. It doesn't make a difference how smart you are who made the guess or what his name is. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. That's all there is to it.
Yeah, thank you.
Happer, thank you very much. We now open the floor to questions. So as I said, if you please raise your hand, if you have a question, wait for the microphone, and then identify yourself and your affiliation. Thank you. Any questions? Over here on the right. Thank you.
Thank you for your remarks, sir. I'm Peter Husey, and I'm president of Geostrategic Analysis, and I am affiliated with the Air Force Association and the American Foreign Policy Council. One of the things I find the reaction, particularly the media, to comments such as yours are they don't look at the facts as much as they look at your motivation. They often assume that if you don't think global warming is a problem, then you don't want to do something about the following: profligate energy use, dependency on oil, and they say that's bad because we're getting it from places where we may rather not. And they say, well, why are you opposed to efficiencies for automobiles and efficiency of using energy for appliances? You look at all the things that, if you believe in global warming as a problem, you then say, well, we must do the following. Couldn't you do all those things even if global warming wasn't a problem, i.e. use energy efficiently, diversify your supply? If it's renewable and makes sense, then it makes sense. So that you don't have to be opposed to the solutions they say, except for when you talk about, well, we're going to tax your carbon footprint. You know, we're going to measure your car, your home, your appliances, your business, and then we're going to send you a bill because your carbon footprint is quote-unquote excessive. Now, there, I think, that's where I think they're going, the proponents, because it's a great way to raise cash. But I want you to address this issue of motivation, because I find most media comments on something like your presentation, they immediately go to the default position that, well, you're in the pocket of the oil industry, or you don't care about profligate energy use, or you want to waste energy and so forth. Could you address that issue?
Okay, of course, you're right that the immediate reaction is not to talk about the science, the fact that there hasn't been any warming, the fact that agriculture is doing much better. None of that is ever discussed. And so they immediately go to ad hominems. And I don't know what to say except that that's the way human beings are. They've been that way for thousands of years. And they're not unlikely to change in our lifetime. I will say that I've never taken a dime from fossil fuel interests, you know, and I give these talks because I'm deeply concerned about what's happening to science. You know, science has been badly corrupted, you know, by all of the money connected with global warming. And, you know, I've known many people who've submitted really good research proposals and good scientific, interesting things in biology and physics, and they get turned down. And then they look at it and they say, oh, but of course this will, you know, affect this part or that part of global warming, and then the proposal gets funded. And it's complete nonsense that they add, and yet it gets them funded. And so if anyone has a conflict of interest, you know, it's the people whose livelihoods now depend on global warming alarmism. I mean, I hate to switch to ad hominems myself, but it's really true that if you look at who's got a conflict of interest, it's not me. You know, it's the fanatics. You know, take the World Wildlife Foundation. You know, they shake huge amounts of money out of their donors. They're sincere people. They're trying to save polar bears and, you know, save the planet for their grandchildren. Of course, it's nonsense. You know, if they wanted to help their grandchildren, they would like to have more CO2 in the air, so there'd be more food. It's already clear there won't be very much warming. So I don't know how to counter that, but it's happened before. For example, in the Lysenko era in the Soviet Union, Lysenko's biology was very much like global warming now. It was maybe plausible the first 4 or 5 years. People tried it out. It was pretty soon clear it didn't work. As Feynman say, you know, you compare with experiment, if it doesn't work, it's not true. But it didn't matter for Lysenko because he had the full backing of the Communist Party. And the Communist Party liked his ideology, you know. You could get thrown into prison, you could lose your job. Some people were executed for, what was their crime? They believed in genes. How dare you believe in genes? You know, that's a capitalist, imperialist plot, you know, and how dare you believe in genes, you know, off to the gulag with you or off to the firing squad. And fortunately, we don't live in a society where, you know, the extremists can do that, although some of them, I think, would like to do that if they could get away with it, but they can't yet. And so I all I can say is I don't know quite how to respond to that except to just constantly explain that, no, I do not take any money from, and most of my colleagues don't take it. They're very concerned about what's happening to the reputation of science. You know, Martin Luther, when, you know, he rose up against the church, he was not against, you know, the morality of Christianity. You know, he was just outraged by the abuse and the corruption that he saw in, you know, what was dear to his heart. So he was not against Christianity, he was not against religion, he was not against morality. And I think many of us feel the same way about science. We look at what's being done to what's almost religion to us, and it just breaks our hearts to see it.
Randy Randall, Dr. Happer. You showed a chart up here where I think it was Der Spiegel had that.
Yeah, Der Spiegel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the issue now is John Christie has pulled out all this data of the most recent IPCC model runs
right.
to say it really is bad. Now, the fact is we have three models in the U.S. One was built and is being operated on your campus.
That's right. Yes.
Now, how in the world do they get it so wrong? And what is it? Is it an algorithm? Is it some kind of a tweak in the model? What they calibrate something internally that we can't see? How do they get?
Let me try and answer. That's a good question. And I think the fundamental problem is if you look at CO2 by itself, it's very hard to get it to warm very much. You know, it's in a saturated region where it's absorbed about as much as it can. Adding more adds a little bit, but not enough to frighten people. So what the modelers had to do to get attention was to add all sorts of positive feedback, typically involving water vapor or clouds. And, you know, they looked a little funny at the time because they were multiplying the effects of CO2 by factors of 3, 4, even 10, you know, and it just seemed very odd that, you know, if you look at most chemical processes, most processes in the world, the feedbacks are negative. You know, positive feedback is very unusual. It occasionally happens. So probably what they screwed up is the feedbacks, is my guess. They're much distorted.
So they never decide to run the experiment that Feynman talked about?
No, the Mother Nature has run the experiment, you know, and to their credit, you know, they made these predictions 20 years ago. So you can go back and look at the predictions. They don't work. But, you know, anyone who's willing to make a prediction has my respect, you know. So I'm big fan of these guys who had the courage to make a prediction. The people I have no respect for are the ones who make retrodictions. Look, we can fit the past, you know, that, yeah, give me a break, you know. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Hi, Adam Rosenberg with the Minority Staff. Some of what I've read with regard to the you know, minimal changes in surface temperatures over the last decade supposedly can be accounted for by ocean absorption of heat, and there seems to be a growing scientific consensus on that, and I don't know if you have any thoughts on this.
Well, that's an example of retrodiction. You know, they didn't predict any ocean warming. You can go look at them. It's not there. So now they didn't work, okay? So you go back and say, oh, well, you know, we should have tweaked this, and it's all gone into the ocean. I will say that, you know, I think you had some physics training.
Yes.
And so if you look at the heat flow models, you know, for the atmosphere and the ocean, it's very, very hard to concoct a model that would warm the ocean and not warm the atmosphere, because the heat load is right at the surface, basically, at the surface of the land, the surface of the ocean. Most of the solar energy is absorbed there. And the thing that has the lowest heat capacity is the air. You know, put a little bit of heat in air, it gets hot in a hurry, and the ocean is not very good. And it also, it's very hard to diffuse heat into the ocean. So there are all sorts of very, very difficult, improbable assumptions you have to make the, only the ocean warm and not the atmosphere. So my guess is that this has not got legs. It will collapse in another 2 or 3 years. You can't measure the heat in the ocean, you know, because the heat capacity of the ocean, you know, is 1,000 times greater than the atmosphere. So that means that if you got, you know, if you predicted 0.3 warming of the atmosphere, you have to divide that by a factor of 1,000 to 10,000 for the ocean. So you're talking about micro degrees of warming. You can't measure that, you know, so it's in the noise of our measurement system. So you could, all right, that's great if you want to manipulate data, because, you know, you just take the noise and you goose it a little bit this way, that way. You can get it to warm, you can get it to cool, but you shouldn't believe any of it. Yeah.
I want to go back a little bit, because as someone who was asked by the Reagan administration when they came in to look at the research being done by the Department of Energy's fossil division with respect to acid rain and the coming ice age, I noticed Mr. Ehrlich, Mr. Holdren, Mr. Sagan, all the people who wrote for Scientific American, Science Magazine, AAAS and NAS, that said we're going to come to a coming ice age,
right,
because of growing carbon,
right,
in the atmosphere, were the same that then switched within a matter of less than a decade,
yeah,
to the same phenomenon,
yeah,
was not going to cause an ice age, but was going to cause global warming.
Yeah.
And what was the trick? Did they get the first one wrong, or are they wrong on both
accounts?
Well,
it was pretty clear by 1985 that it was warming. You know, the minimum temperature was about 1977. And so it didn't take these guys long to realize they got the sign wrong. And there's a joke in physics that, you know, you describe things with an equation. It's the hardest thing to get right in an equation is a sign, you know, so. Yeah, sign doesn't, you know, everything else in the equation, you can check the dimension, you check the units, all of that's easy to check, but you can't check the sign. It doesn't have any dimensions. Yeah.
Question at the end.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Cynthia Sue. I'm a AAAS science fellow here on the Hill. Could you talk a little bit about what confounding principles are when you talk about agriculture and things that affect plant growth? What are the other confounding principles that would also affect plant growth that have happened over the past 30 years that have increased yield?
Well, you should read the paper that I put up. I put the reference, you know, and you can read it. The most obvious one is rainfall, you know, especially in these desert areas where the signal was strongest. And so you can look at the rainfall and take that out, which the authors claim to have done. So by far the biggest one is water.
Genetic modifications and increases in breeding, changes
well, not,
in
you
practices,
know, look,
the pesticide
Western
use.
Desert in Australia, you know, the Sahel. I'm not quite sure what question I'm answering.
What are some of the confounding factors other than carbon dioxide that could explain yield?
Increasing yield. Well, I told you the. Oh, you mean for the controlled experiments, or for the satellite measurements of the greening of the earth, or which experiments do you have in mind?
In general, for plant growth and agriculture, increasing yields, You made the statement that carbon dioxide is one factor.
I probably have hoed more rows of corn than you have. And I can tell you, you know, agriculture, it depends on good fertilizer, depends on good seed, depends on luck. If you have a good year, you make a big crop. If you have a bad year, you don't do so well. So luck is involved. It depends on cropping practices. You know, if you're stupid and you plow up and down a hill, then the first big rain, you know, erodes your entire field, you lose everything. So there's dozens of things that are involved. And farmers are very, very fussy, you know. A good farmer is really better than a good physicist, you know. They have a much harder job. But they're also extremely particular, you know. There's a joke you may have heard that, you know, what's impossible for God? And the answer is to please a farmer, you know. Something is always wrong, you know. If the weather's too hot, it's too cold, you know. The seed was wrong, you know. So they're hard people to live with. But there's no doubt that CO2 is causing greening.
Are the farmers going to back you on this and rise up and protest?
Well, you know, I've seen polls. Most farmers think it's nonsense. You know, they're not worried about it. You know, they have other things to worry about, as I explained over there. You know, they're worried about the weather. You know, they're worried about, you know, crop subsidies, the price of fertilizer. This is sort of the bottom of their list.
Except you mentioned that CO2 counteracts some of the effects of weather.
Yeah, well, I think certainly the farmers who operate greenhouses, and some do recognize that to the extent that they're willing to pay for CO2 to add to their greenhouse.
Hi, I'm Marianne Lalonde. I'm a AAAS science fellow. Some of the plots that you showed, the time frame goes back to before the existence of humans.
Right.
So I was wondering if you could comment on a more zoomed in version of that plot showing the carbon dioxide levels effect not on human life but on other animal life. And so humans,
right,
were okay on a scale of to thousands of ppm of CO2, but there may be some other animals that we're relying on that are more delicate. Can you comment on that?
Well, very few. I don't think any animals that I know of are sensitive to high levels of CO2 because, you know, the experiment has been done by the Earth. You know, over most of geological history, CO2 levels have been thousands of parts per billion, 1,000, 2,000. And our primate ancestors, when they evolved, you know, it's a little controversial, but roughly 80 million years ago, CO2 levels were several thousand parts per million. They did fine. You often hear, it's going to acidify the oceans, you know. It's not just warming. Even if there's no warming, you know, everything will dissolve in the ocean. Nature has done the experiment. And, you know, when it was 2,000 or 3,000 parts per million, the oceans teemed with life. There's coral, you know, deposits everywhere, you know. So. And if you go, if you actually calculate the drop in pH from more CO2, pH of the ocean is extremely variable, but a round number might be 8.1, somewhat alkaline. So, you know, if you double or triple, you might drive that down below 8, might get to 7.9. But, you know, if you go out to the Chesapeake Bay today, if the sun were shining, you would find that, you know, at the end of the day, the pH would probably be around 7.8, you know, and at night it would start to increase. I've got it backwards. if you went there in the morning, it would be around 7.8. At the end of the day, it would be maybe 8.2, 8.3. So a typical water body pH varies by half a unit from day to night. And the reason for that is that when the sun is shining, all of the plankton are sucking in as much CO2 as they can, so they're stripping the water of CO2. It can't diffuse in very efficiently. You know, there's an air-water interface. It isn't a good impedance match, so they suck it all out. and therefore it gets more alkaline because there isn't CO2, carbonic acid, to counter the natural alkalinity of the ocean. And then at night, you know, there's no sun, and so they start respiring, so CO2 comes out, so it gets a little more acidic during the night, but it's still alkaline, so it goes from 8.4 to 7.9 or something like that. You can do the experiments. There's lots of papers on them. And so life is extremely well adapted to changes in pH. You know, little changes in pH don't make the slightest difference because the natural changes in pH are huge compared to what CO2 can change. Yeah, I mean, if you just go down in depth, for example, you go to the Pacific and you go down, pH is off Hawaii is at the surface is 8.1. You go down 2,000 or 3,000 feet, you know, it's 7.8, 7.6. That's because of the organic detritus falling down. You know, it oxidizes as it gets to depth, and there's no photosynthesis to recover it. And so the ocean and all bodies of water never have stable pH. River pH is, you know, 4, 4.5, 5, you know. So the first thing that, you know, life learned how to do was to make membranes with you know, proton pumps in it so it could control the pH inside the cell. Your own cells are like that, you know. That's how mitochondria actually provide energy. It's from pH pumps. So there's nothing to the argument there's a problem with pH. I don't know. I mean, maybe I've said enough about this, but we could talk offline if you'd like. Yeah.
Hi, Eric Cho from the House Oversight Committee. I deal with acquisition policy issues, so this is kind of foreign to me, but it's very enlightening. Thank you. Of all the, I guess, community of scientists that do care about the truth, I assume that there are many of those. And yet, as a common public, I hear, I guess, several years ago, while Michael Crichton was alive, you know, read The Set of Fear, the novel.
Yeah.
And you kind of pointing out the other way of looking at the same issues. So my question is that of the community of the scientists that care about the truth, are you like the true minority? What is the status of the scientific, I guess, consensus?
Well, I'm certainly a minority, but less of a minority than I was 5 years ago. Certainly within my community of physics, and we know a lot about climate. When I first got concerned about this, I would guess that maybe 20% felt like me. Most of them were afraid to say anything. But now I would say that at least 30% feel like me, and more of them are courageous enough to speak up than 5 years ago. And the reason is what Feynman said. They've all looked at the data, and they can't believe what they're seeing. You know, you showed us all these models about what the temperature would be, and it hasn't done that. You know, it couldn't be more wrong. And so at least in my community of physics, you know, when a model doesn't work, you start asking, okay, what's wrong, you know? And so I think that, you know, we have Mother Nature on our side. That's what, strong ally.
We have time for one last question. Anyone have a final question?
Okay.
In which case, I'll take the final question. I'll abuse my position as executive director. Professor Happer, could you perhaps distill your presentation down into a policy takeaway for policymakers in terms of what should they be really, really interested in and care about when it comes to CO2, or should they not care about it at all? What is the actual policy takeaway from here?
I would say that CO2 is probably, for a policymaker, if it were only CO2, it's clearly a positive for humanity. However, CO2 often involves many other things besides just the CO2 that is released when you burn something. So, for example, if you mine an area, you know, you can leave a real mess, you know, to get the coal to make the CO2. The mess is actually quite a bit worse than the gain that you get from the CO2 if you're not careful. And so I would say that the policy message I have is all of us are environmentalists. All of us want a good environment, you know. And so why don't you focus on the things that really matter, you know, like uncontrolled strip mining, uncontrolled coal plants like China. You know, I spend a lot of time in China. It's just disgraceful what's happening in China. And it's not because of CO2. It's because of fly ash. It's because of sulfur. It's all sorts of things that we long ago learned to control in this country. It's not that hard to control. It's not even that expensive, but the Chinese don't, because you can bribe some inspector and you don't have to add that little cost and you make that much more money. So it's a corruption problem. And so I think, you know, CO2 is like, for some of these people, it's like the red flag, you know, the matador, you know, come charge this CO2, you know, and in the meantime, he skewers, you know, fly ash.
Okay, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Happer. Okay, so thank you very much for your time, and also thank you again for braving this horrible weather today. Just a quick administrative notice, the slides and the video of this event will be uploaded onto our website by the next 36 hours, Drew, about then? Okay, we'll certainly notify everybody when that happens. Our next event to do with climate energy will be on November 17th, where we will be doing a post-mortem of the midterm elections and their implications for U.S. energy policy. We'll be sending out a notice nearer the time about that event as well. So thank you for your time, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.